Hi, I'm Dave Ciaccio, comedy nerd. And this is Old Timers at Bob's Big Boy. One of my favorite things is sitting down with Hollywood's comedy veterans to pick their brains, find out how they did it, why they did it, and possibly learn how I might do it too. Tonight I'm chatting with Ken Greewald, who has dedicated his life to comedy. He's appeared on The Steve Allen Show, The Mike Douglas Show, acted in commercials, co-starred in sitcoms, sketch TV, and is an Academy Award-nominated filmmaker.
So you're a fan of comedy?
I'm more than a fan of comedy. You know that.
You've been comedy your whole life.
Yes, I have. From the age of 10. Just 70 years.
70 years of comedy.
Who would have thought?
I want to know how you did that.
Well, I was influenced at an early age by Danny Kaye. I used to pantomime to Danny Kaye records.
Yeah.
So my mother said, there's a contest. We put you up. They'll play a record of Danny Kaye's and pantomime to it. Maybe you'll win something.
What do you mean pantomime to it?
Screenplay by Gluck, from a stage play by Motz, from a story by Blip, from a chapter by Rung, from a sentence by Doakes, from a comma by Stokes, from an idea by Grokes, based on a Joe Miller's a joke.
Okay, you're lip syncing?
I'm lip syncing.
And dancing?
Well, I moved. I was a kid. What do I know from dancing? So I did it and I won first prize, which was, for a kid, a hamburger.
You won a hamburger?
That was
your first paying comedy gig at 10 years old.
10 years old, and I said, wow, I love this. I love the feeling of people applauding and appreciating what I do.
Uh-huh.
And so I got hooked.
It's addicting, isn't it?
It is.
Speaking of hamburgers, are you hungry?
Oh.
Feel free to order whatever you want. It's on me, except...
Except the tip.
Stay away from the steak.
Okay. How about a Cobb salad? Is that okay?
I'm going to get a burger.
Mind if I take my hat off?
Please. Make yourself at home.
Hi.
Hello.
A Cobb salad, please.
Okay.
I'll have the original Big Boy.
Mm-hmm.
Does that come with fries?
Can I steal a fry or two from you?
You can have one fry.
Okay, one fry.
What dressing on the salad?
Blue cheese.
Okay.
And can I have a side of ranch also? And
can I make up your mind, a blue cheese or ranch?
I want both. Why do I have to decide on just one?
So you're one of those guys.
Can I also have an iced tea, please?
Sure.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
So
you were a child actor, right?
My mother said, I want you to go into the Screen Children's Guild. It doesn't exist anymore. Like the Screen Actors Guild, they formed the Screen Children's Guild.
This is like in the 40s?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, this was in the 40s. And they were making a film in 1948 called The Argyle Secret. Written by Cy Enfield, who was a film director. And he was also a writer for radio, because radio was very hot at that time.
Uh-huh.
Because there was no television. Nobody heard the television, except a few people. So they needed someone who could play the violin, a kid that could play the violin.
Uh-huh.
That's how I got the part in The Argyle Secret.
Hello, Gerald. Remember me?
I don't know you. Hey, Ma!
Do you remember going in and auditioning at 12 years old for that part?
Yes, I did. I auditioned for it. Can you play the violin, he said. Yes, sir. I said, hold that violin over there. I held the violin. Put it up to your chin. I put it up to my chin. Let me see you play. And I played. I could play very well then. And he said, you're hired. I said, well, what do I do now? He said, go home with your mother. I'll call you.
Do you still remember?
Oh, God, I do. I still remember. Chin this way. Bring your arm over. Oh, that was always the hardest part. William Gargan was the star of it. Well known.
Who's William Gargan? Did he do a lot of movies? I don't know.
I know you don't know. William Gargan was very popular in the 30s and 40s.
Yeah.
He really was. And he ended up on television playing Martin Caine.
Martin Caine, Private Eye, starring William Gargan.
And the interesting thing was, shortly after that film was made, Cy Enfield was indicted as a communist by the House Un-American Activities Committee.
Oh, wow.
And I actually did not get a chance to see it again until 2 years ago. Over 50 years went by before I had a chance to see this thing.
Did they bury it because he was indicted?
That was one of the reasons they buried it. But he made a number of films in England and settled in England.
Water,
ooh, thank
soda.
You.
You're welcome. And salad.
Yes,
there you
thanks
go.
Very much.
You're welcome.
What did your parents do? Were they in entertainment?
No, they were not. They didn't even understand entertainment at all. My dad was a dress designer.
That's a creative field.
Creative and sophisticated clothing my father designed. My mom was a housewife. She came from a long line of bakers, though. And everywhere you went in the house, there was food in the form of cakes, mm-hmm. cookies, and candies. And I became a fat little kid.
But they were supportive.
Well, they were supportive of my talent, yes. Mm-hmm. Up to a point.
Up to a point?
As long as I was a kid.
Oh.
Once I got to be an adult, they wanted me to become a doctor, maybe even an Indian chief, but anything but
anything,
being an entertainer.
But an entertainer. That's all.
Enjoy.
Thank you very much. Help yourself to fries.
Two fries.
Have all you want.
Thank you.
So how did you get into stand-up?
So I was palling around with a guy named Paul Robbins. Wish I knew where he is today. One day he says to me, "You're so damn funny." Really? I didn't hear this from people. You do all this stuff and I'm in hysterics. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to write this stuff down. So you're going to write it down. What for? So I can give it to you so you can use it.
Were there open mics? Or well, was it?
There were no open mics.
Where do you
mics?
Do comedy in the 50s?
Yeah, where do you do comedy in the 50s? You find a place. I'm working at the Ash Grove.
The gypsy roller come over there.
It was a place where folk music was tops. I ran the lights and I ran the sound. Ed Pearl comes to me and says, "We got a cancellation. Get out the phone book. We got to get someone to fill in the spot." Mm-hmm. And I said, "Ed, could I fill in this spot?" He said, "What are you talking about?" I said, "Comedy. Can you do 10 minutes? I said, "Yeah, I can do 10 minutes. And I'm shaking like a leaf because I never performed in my life. I get up and I do 10 minutes.
Was there a crowd?
And they liked me. And I said, "This is neat.
Yeah.
I really like this." And I fell in love with doing comedy.
Now, how old were you then?
I was about 20. And so I went back to my job as sound and lighting. And I noticed that there were places you could go to, nightclubs. And this was the era when coffee houses were starting to appear.
Uh-huh.
Suddenly we get the Ice House. I auditioned, I got hired. And pretty soon there were different places. The Comedy Store was established.
Uh-huh.
So I started performing at the Comedy Store. On the outside they have Black Wall. And on the Black Wall are names of all the comedians that have come through there. And I'm proud to say my name is up there.
Still there?
Still there.
So this was the beginning of kind of the stand-up comedy boom.
I was part of that boom.
Often people want to know how you start this job, you know, how you get started. And
did you always want to be a comedian?
Not in the womb, but right after that, yes, it seemed.
And my mother was kind of weird, because my mother used to cry. You know, my mother said, "It hurts me more than it hurts you." You know, and we say, "Well, let us be you."
Let me describe it to you. A cold winter morning in New York, I'm curled up in my bed in womb position, having a sex dream, invariably. Maybe not actually, but symbolically. Hot dogs chasing donuts through the Lincoln Tunnel. Whatever, it's a sex dream.
The original boom started in the 50s.
Okay.
But it wasn't called the boom. It was just everybody either worked at a nightclub or at a restaurant, and that was it. In the 60s, they started to consolidate. They had clubs that were specially designed, like the Ice House and the Comedy Store, for comedy.
So were you getting paid to do comedy then?
Well, when I first started, I wasn't getting any pay at all.
Besides hamburgers.
The Troubadour was my first paying gig. I got paid $55 Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, two times a night. Friday and Saturday, three times a night.
That's 55 a night?
No, that's a week. I was actually paid $75, and Doug Weston brought me into his office and he said, we're not making as much money on Jimmy Rogers as we thought. So we have to cut back your salary from 75 to 55. I said, you're paying him over $1,000. Why can't you cut back his salary? I'm getting bupkis.
Yeah.
And he said, take it or leave it. So I took it.
You took it.
I took it because I wanted to continue.
You did the Steve Allen show, right?
I got to tell you this story.
Yeah.
All the comedians were looking for agents. So I went to a guy, Alan Bursky, who was a comedian. I said, Alan, do you know an agency? He said, yeah, I know, General Artists Agency, GAC, General Artists Corporation. I said, do you know anybody there? He said, yeah. Gave me the name of the guy, and I said, thank you. I went home, I dialed the phone. In those days, it was this rotary dial.
Yeah.
And I called the agency. So the first thing out of my mouth, I said, how would you like to make 10% without lifting a finger?
Yeah.
Of course he was interested. I told him who I was, and he said, God, you got a lot of balls. I said, you know that, you gotta have that in the business. He said, that's true. I tell you what I'd like you to do, I told him. I have a film, there was no such thing as video at that time.
Yeah.
I have a film I'd like you to send to the Johnny Carson show in New York so that they can see my comedy. And he said, well, I can do that. And I said, I'll tell you when. And he said, okay. I got off the phone. I called Johnny Carson show in New York and asked for the casting director. Mm-hmm. I used the GAC agent's name, told him I was the agent. I told him, raved about a new comedian. And I said, I'm going to send out a kinescope for you to look at. And he said, do that. Then I called back the agent and I said, send it to this address, and he sent it out. I got a reply. At least I got a reply.
Yeah.
We don't like your kind of comedy. So he called me back and he said, I got you an audition for the new Steve Allen show. Alan Sherman, the folk singer, hello mutta, hello fada.
Hello mutta. Hello fada. Here I am at Camp Granada. Camp is very entertaining. And they say we'll have some fun if it stops raining.
He was the producer of the show. All of these talented people were sitting there, singers, dancers, acrobats. My turn, I got up and I did my comedy. Soon as I finish, Alan Sherman stands up and says, you're hired. It was the greatest moment of my life.
Kenny Greenwald.
So I was comedian of the week. I was on five nights. I had accumulated, by the time I was 26, 3.5 hours of material. And I remembered it all. Now, at the age of 80, I don't remember all of it. But I remember some of it.
You remember some of it, don't you?
Yeah, I do.
I want you to visualize a farmhouse at night, somewhere in Kansas, and a wheat field. And high above in the sky, a flying saucer.
And a strange thing happened.
Yeah.
I was never called back, and I didn't know why. And then one day I get a phone call from the Steve Allen Show a year later, and they want me on the show. So I go see the casting director. So I go into his office, and he says, "You're going to be on the Steve Allen Show this week, and I'll tell you the date." And he looked at me, and I said, "How come I haven't been called since Alan Sherman left?" "Because I don't like you. I don't like your style of comedy.
Wow.
It's too foreign to me. You don't tell jokes. You do kind of strange stuff. And you're only on the show because Steve Allen wanted you back on the show. And he sent me a note, and he showed me the note. Get Ken Greenwald. I want him on the show."
Really?
Steve.
How was Steve?
Wonderful. He helped me. He asked me questions about my comedy. He just gave me advice.
Yeah.
He said, "If you're nervous, tell them you're nervous.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Show them that you're nervous. If you're not nervous, show them that you're having a lot of fun.
Uh-huh.
And most of all, take them on a trip. Have fun on your trip. You don't have to say a word to them, the audience. Just, they'll know you're going to do something and you're going on a trip. Because what you do is like a trip."
"I'd like to take you back to Cape Canaveral, 1956, and tell you the true story about our attempts to get rockets into the sky. Bring out Monster 5. Well, that's pretty big. Load in the astronaut. Good job, fellas. He's in there.
I don't want to go.
From that point on, he kept hiring me. Hoffman was fired, and two of the writers became the producers, and they loved me. And they kept hiring me. I was on for 22 times.
The Steve Allen Show was after his stint on the Tonight Show.
He started on radio.
Yeah.
With the Night Show.
Okay. It's
the Steve Allen's Night Show on radio, late night.
Yeah.
I believe he went to New York to take over the Tonight Show.
"In case you're just joining us, this is Tonight. And I can't think of too much to tell you about it, except I want to give you the bad news first. This program is going to go on forever." "Boy, you think you're tired now." "Wait till you see 1 o'clock roll around."
And then he came back to California and the Westinghouse television network.
It's the Steve Allen Show. From the Steve Allen Playhouse on Vine Street in the heart of Hollywood, we bring you 90 minutes of madness and melody with guest stars Mel Torme, Jenny Smith, songwriter Sammy Fain, log roller Diane Ellison, musical bicyclist Frank Zappa, Don Brenner and his orchestra, and yours truly, Johnny J.
He was so well known in the 60s. Everybody loved him. He was one of the most amazing men. He would go up on a crane outside the Hollywood Ranch Market, and he would dive into an artificial swimming pool.
Human teabag time. Here we go.
So he was sort of the predecessor of what, like, Letterman was doing.
Letterman copied what Steve Allen used to do. Steve Allen was the best. He really was. He was a kind person, he was a giving person, and so talented.
Did people start to recognize you then?
Yes, they recognized me. I was driving my car one time and I came up to a stoplight and someone said, "Hey, I saw you on the Steve Allen Show. You're that funny comedian guy." And I said, "Thank you very much. It's okay." Oh, the Arrow shirt commercial. Oh, I saw you in the Aero shirt commercial. That was a funny commercial.
This is a stick-up. What? I'm sorry, excuse me. What was that you said, sir?
I want all the cash you've got.
Well, we generally have charge customers. We don't handle any cash at all. You could accept some merchandise.
That's 38 with a gun.
That was an unusual commercial because I helped to write that commercial.
Oh, you did?
And it's a special commercial. It runs 2 minutes. They bought out Johnny Carson, Joey Bishop, and Dick Cavett. And I was seen on all three networks in 70 and 71. I was the hot one.
With things like first-class leg space, Western makes you as comfortable in the air as you are in your own living room.
In 69, I was already in two television series.
So you were in Turn-On.
Yes, I was. Infamous.
I read about that, yeah.
Infamous.
It is infamous.
Hi, boys and girls. It's time to turn on.
Tonight we invite you to turn on with our guests, Robert Culp, Franz Neuen, plus Bonnie Boland, Hamilton Camp, Teresa Graves, Maxine Green, Ken Greenwald.
This is a sketch comedy show on ABC, right?
Yes.
In 1969.
Right.
It was a multicultural cast too, right?
A multicultural. There was Mel Stewart was on that. That was a time. The Watts riots were happening.
You are now the first black justice of the Supreme Court. Congratulations, boy.
Doctor, I have destroyed everything around me. Job, marriage, family, friends, and I'm still not happy.
After my wife had her sixth child, somehow she changed.
People didn't like that in 69.
Yeah, that's pretty edgy for
that 69. Was edgy.
So it just aired one episode and then they pulled the rug
it
out?
It didn't even air on the West Coast to the Midwest. It only half a show aired.
Why? Because it was...
People didn't understand the quick cuts. There were no such things as quick cuts and fast dialogue. Jokes on that show took 10 seconds.
Drink?
Oh, no thanks. I'm driving.
Did you get that? It went by so fast. Did you get that? People picked up their phones and called ABC and protested. They'd never seen anything like this, not just the political aspect of it and the freedom that was being shown on the screen, but the editing. The stuff was going by too fast.
And which is second nature now on TV.
It's everywhere.
When did you start doing short films?
I turned 20, 21. I'm in UCLA.
Film school?
What do you think? I was there in the early days when they only had one soundstage. No major studio equipment except in one place. We had one studio. They were so poor that they would print a film, hand the film to a student, say, now put it together. Uh-huh. And the guy would put it together, and he would be graded on it, and then he was told, take it apart and put it the way it was originally before you edit it.
So
someone else could do it again. And we did. We all did. All the students did that. But that wasn't enough. And I quit the school because I said, I want to tell stories. So in 71, I wanted to make a film with Denny Evans. I was in Harvey Lembeck's comedy improv workshop, and Denny Evans and I became good friends. Mm-hmm. We wrote a script, and we picked Vern Rowe, the actor, who was in the class also. Vern was just, his face looked like a bulldog.
Is this Good Morning?
Good Morning. We were going to shoot, but we didn't have sound. So I said, what could we shoot where we wouldn't need sound? And we finally decided, a guy alone. He's uh-huh. not talking to anybody. So we worked out this story, and we filmed it in my apartment. we shot it on 16, and then I rented a moviola, and I watched every scene, and I said, okay, he opens the refrigerator door and closes it. And so I went to my refrigerator, and I opened the door, and I closed it while I tape recorded the sound. I recorded every sound that I felt was important in the film. Then I went, because I knew my friends at UCLA, and he said, 3 a.m., nobody's at the UCLA dubbing room. Go in that room, nobody's gonna know you're in the room, transfer it to magnetic film. Not a penny spent. And then, wait a minute, Academy Awards, they're asking for entries.
Yeah.
I went to the Palms Theater and I said, I have this movie, can you show it for a week? You had to qualify.
Because you had to qualify to.
That's right.
That it was showing somewhere?
That it was showing in Los Angeles for a week, 7 days.
Okay.
For a week it was playing at the Palms. I invited all my friends. And then I submitted it to the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences. By this time I was working on quiz shows. Suddenly the Academy calls me and says, your film has been nominated for an Academy Award. I said, what, could you repeat that? And they said, we went through all the films and we've chosen your film, Good Morning, as one of the entries that has won an Academy Award nomination.
Wow.
You mean I'm gonna go to the Academy Awards?
Live, the 44th Annual Academy Awards presentation.
I met Gregory Peck, Karen Black, I met Charlie Chaplin. He was walking around from table to table. He was as spry as could be. That was the year that he got his award.
Lifetime Achievement Award.
Oh, you're wonderful, sweet people. Thank you.
There's always something in your first film that you don't have in your next.
Yeah.
It's your first time out and you're new to it. There's something exciting about it that you can never capture. It's like having your first malted milk.
Yeah.
You know, oh, malt. Oh, this tastes so terrific. And you'll never get that taste again.
Yeah. Sketch comedy is really big right now.
I love sketch comedy.
And what you do on stage
is I'm the whole sketch.
Is you're the whole sketch. And I've seen you go to UCB in front of 120-year-olds and kill with a one-person sketch that's just all you.
Thank you.
People
for
are
that.
Still doing your sort of comedy, but it's usually three or four people doing it.
I know.
Just one.
I know. If I play Dracula with the voice. Icky, talk to me. All right, what do you want, master? I don't talk so fast. Yes, I know, but don't talk so fast. You know, I'm doing all of this one stuff at a time.
Where did that come from? How did you start doing your sound effects and your characters? And
I grew up with that stuff. I would see Sid Caesar in 51 and 53.
Uh-huh.
He had two shows. Your show of shows in 51, 50, 51, and then the Sid Caesar show in 53.
Du hast geklippte Stirn! Du hast geklippte Stirn im Kopf!
Was ist denn, Herr General? Stirn anklippt!
And I would watch him intensely and I would say, he's doing a German accent. I can do that. I can do that. I can do this German accent just as good as he can. Yes, sorry, I can! And I would do that, and then he's doing a Frenchman. I can do that. Yes, sir, I can do French. French as can be. And that's how I started accumulating what was to be my comedy. And then Jonathan Winters comes along.
Uh-huh.
I can do that. He was doing stand-up and sound effects. Jonathan Winters was very popular back in the 50s and 60s. I was introduced to him. I'd never met him before, but I was using sound effects and I was in awe of this man.
Yeah.
He and Sid Caesar were my idols. That man did not stop talking for an hour and a half. And we were in hysterics. We were in tears, streaming from our eyes with tears. We were wiping away the tears of laughter.
Hello there. I'm Dr. Jameson. Is Dr. Frelick here? Obviously, you're not the doctor.
Is anybody today doing the kind of comedy that you were doing?
Robin Williams and I became friends in Harvey Limbick's comedy workshop. He did my kind of stuff 10 years after I started doing it.
Yeah.
But he elaborated even more than I did.
Systems overload, ego check, everything failing, lips. All system overload, ego check 9, phase in now. Help me!
And I would talk to Robin about comedy, and he would talk incessantly about comedy and movies and stuff like that. But the minute I would talk to him about, you know, why did you do this on the stage? What was your motivational reason to go in that direction and cut yourself off from this direction, he wouldn't talk about it. He would change the subject immediately.
Do you think he didn't know on a sort of like conscious level?
No, I think he was consciously
aware.
Or he
just didn't want to
because,
talk about it.
Because what was his co-star, Pam Dauber?
Pam Dauber, yeah.
Yeah, she said the same thing. He had me on a show one time, his Mork and Mindy. Oh,
but I'm Mork not,
you don't see me. Yeah. He used my voice as the voice of his space suit. So I was...
Mark, you talk to your space suit?
Yeah, I talk to my space suit.
Oh,
you talk to your space suit?
Yeah, I talk to my space suit.
Space suit, good to see you. Oh, of course I miss you. Yes, yes. You see, I have to wear Earth clothing now that I'm here on Earth.
It's
true.
I miss him. Really miss him.
What do you think is the secret to supporting yourself for 60 years in comedy?
By doing everything creative I can. I supported myself by being an assistant in a radio archives.
Uh-huh.
I acted in commercials.
Uh-huh.
I'm a cartoonist, so I cartoon.
Yeah.
I'm a writer. I write my material, and I'm also a filmmaker.
So any job that I can do, I do.
I keep thinking creatively when I can. I mean, I have to live an everyday life. You have to do the laundry, you have to do the dishes, you have to feed yourself and all of that. You've got to sustain yourself. I know people... writers who have taken jobs as dishwashers and become writers.
Mm-hmm.
And
it's a hard job, the job of comedian. Would you do it again, the life of comedy and film?
That's a very good question. I don't know. You know, one of the greatest things that happened to me was I found out that Stan Laurel was living in an apartment building in Santa Monica.
Hey, Ollie.
What?
You got a match?
What do you want with it?
I want to light the oven.
Oh, go and sit down. You get on my nerves. I'll light it. Anytime I want something done right, I always have to do it myself.
In the 30s, he was living in mansion-type places.
Uh-huh.
But now, as retired and not being used for years, he didn't have the money he had.
That's amazing. Yes. Somebody that famous.
Yeah, you'd think he could live in luxury. So I picked up the phone and I
called his number.
And he made an appointment with me. I dragged a 60-pound projector and a 30-pound speaker up to his apartment, set it up. I looked around the apartment. I can't tell you how thrilled I was to see all the memorabilia that he had of him and Oliver Hardy. It was just amazing. Anyway, I showed him the film, and he spent 5 to 10 minutes analyzing my comedy. He said my movements were good, my comedy ideas were good, but why don't I wear a costume? And I said, because it's not my style of comedy.
Yeah.
He said, if you wore something to identify you, and I knew when he said that, he was right, because he and Oliver Hardy had derbies.
Yeah.
And Charlie Chaplin had the mustache, and Buster Keaton had the pork pie hat, and Harold Lloyd had the glasses. Abbott and Costello, they liked Laurel and Hardy. One was fat and one was thin.
Yeah.
You know, so he came from that school, and so he thought, get some kind of costume that people can identify you with. But I was too versatile. I did too many things.
Yeah.
So I didn't fit his mold.
What did you wear as a comedian? Just a suit and tie?
Oh, yeah. In the 60s, you wore suit and ties. You had to wear a suit and tie.
Mm-hmm.
Wherever you appeared, it didn't matter. Even in a folk club, you had to wear a suit and tie.
Yeah.
Then it eased up. Toward the end of the 60s, it eased up. You could come with a no tie on and stuff. And then pretty soon, you come dressed as you were, beard and all. It was a great time.
It's almost mandatory to have a beard and a flannel shirt now.
It's almost mandatory to have an incomplete beard, just a stubble. I've noticed in movies and in television, how do they keep it just at the stubble stage? They must measure it.
I don't want to commit too hard to the beard.
That's great. That's wonderful.
So you were doing comedy throughout the 60s and into the 70s.
I never stopped doing comedy.
You're still doing comedy.
I'm still doing comedy.
Mr. Ken Greewald.
Wait now to sometimes till late at night. They pick my name out of a hat with 100 other, well, actually 20 others, and I might go on one night at 7:30, which is preferable, you have a full audience, or at 11:30 or 12 when there's hardly anybody there.
Two drunk guys left, yeah.
Two drunk guys left. There's so many clubs that are saying, come comedians, come, show us your work, but you don't get paid.
Right.
You're not our main act. We might put you on later.
And you got to bring 10 friends or else.
And
got to
bring
10
friends, yeah. And I don't do that. I don't bring 10 friends.
I don't have 10 friends.
I don't have 10 friends either. Most of mine are dead.
Your job, the money you're making, all the pressure of politics and everything, and it's raging inside you and you want to get it out and you can't. Don't. What you want to do is take it out on someone you don't know. How many people pass you and you'll never see them again? Stop one of them. And just say to them, I don't know you, and I don't want to know you, and walk away.
What time is it? 2 a.m.
Appreciate you being here, Ken.
It's my
pleasure. That was fascinating talking to you.
Same here.